Campaigning for a light heavyweight championship of the world. That unquenchable inner rage dominates everything Tony does in and outside the ring. It has kept him in the headlines in a way he might not have liked since the loss to Jones. We thought we knew a lot about James Toney when he entered the ring against Roy Jones last November. Undefeated, two-time champion, one of the best fighters pound for pound in boxing. What we didn't know was what James Toney would do when he left the ring 12 devastating rounds later, forced to deal with the first loss of his career.
And new super middleweight champion of the world, Roy Jones Jr.
2 days after the loss, James Toney stormed out of a meeting at the home of his manager, Jackie Callan, after she suggested he could take a rematch with Jones at 168 pounds, a weight that Toney had struggled to make, leaving him somewhere less than his best.
I said, Jackie, I won't hear no more about no 168. Here she is, bumping the gums, blabbing at the mouth, saying, we can do this at 168 and this and that. And that's what set me off right there.
Then Toney was told Callan had worried during the fight about a proposed multi-million dollar deal with HBO, contingent on his beating Jones. Toney concluded Callan's only concern was the money.
I wanted him to be motivated. You know, I wanted him to realize we had a real big deal sitting on the table, a very large one. Actually, it was the largest deal that's ever been offered to anybody other than a heavyweight, and I was real excited about that, as was James. I mean, that's what basically you want out of any career you choose is financial success. And when I saw the fight slipping away, I knew he needed a knockout in order for that deal to actually happen. And I guess I was just thinking out loud when I said, oh my God, he's got to win or that deal's out the window.
That was totally uncalled for. And I lost a lot of respect for her because she said that.
That loss of respect almost ignited an act of violence.
Detroit boxing manager Jackie Callan
is getting
fed
about 10:30
last night. His son shattered a glass table allegedly.
But last night, she called the West Bloomfield police for help.
Jackie Callan,
James Toney's mother called to say that James was threatening to kill her.
On the surface, things appear to have calmed down now. But as Toney sets out to conquer the light heavyweight division, he leaves no doubt his business circumstances have changed.
Right now, I'm the boss. I'm in control of everything. Nobody can do nothing but me. James is calling the shots. I'm gonna do what I want to do. If they don't like it, they can kiss my butt, because it's my show now.
Trainer Bill Miller thinks James may be making a serious mistake in his approach to dealing with his first loss.
It'd be a wake-up call for him. This thing's for real out here. This is not a one-man show out here. Boxing's not run by one individual, run by many. A young guy like James with his attitude couldn't manage himself. You know, he got fighters managing themselves. He couldn't manage himself. Too hot-headed.
For now, James Toney is still managed by Jackie Callan, but her contract expires in July, and James has given her anything but a vote of confidence.
I'm still going to do what I've always done for James, and then when July comes, you know, we'll sit down and we'll talk and we'll see where his head is at and his heart, where his career is at, because I don't really believe anybody else could do a better job for him or care more about him than I have. And I really worry that if he were to end up with the wrong person who wouldn't be understanding of him, they really could, you know, have a clash and something bad could happen.
I don't trust a damn soul. I don't even trust my damn self no more. So I ain't trusting nobody. I just gotta do what I gotta do. You know, I got this I don't care attitude. I got this you attitude. I don't care. And then, you know, I'm going back to my old self, how I used to be, when everybody supposedly said I was a gangbanging drug dealer. That's, I'm going back to my old ways. I have to be, because I got to defend myself now. People like her, who claim they don't care about you, but then stab you in the back. Big-ass knife wound, this one.
And this week's update, James and Jackie have gone out of their way to present an image of solidarity, walked into a news conference a couple of days holding hands. No word about what happens in July, but for the moment, the picture they present is that everything is back together. You think we've heard the last of this, Larry?
I doubt it, Jim. Jackie herself reminded me that it was Ernest Hemingway who said, never fall in love with a fighter. One way or another, it'll break your heart.
Tail of the tape for this light heavyweight battle, and you'll see that James Toney enters the ring having made weight at 175 pounds. It wasn't all that easy for him. He has a 4-inch height advantage over the unusually short 5'7" light heavyweight 1992 Olympian Montel Griffith.
Just hours before the weigh-in, Toney was spotted working out in a spa, losing weight. I suspect that if he was a sumo wrestler with a 350-pound limit, he'd still have to work to make weight.
Punch stat numbers, Larry.
Take a look at the activity of these fighters. Griffith is not a very active fighter. He's a cautious boxer puncher. Toney generally comes down to fight at what, or up to fight at whatever level his opponent fights at. Not going to see many jabs from Griffin. He likes to hook. Going to see some good jabs from Toney, who works off it with everything else.
Rules of the bout with our unofficial ringside scorer, Harold Lederman.
The James Toney Montel Griffin fight tonight will be 12 rounds. There is no standing eight count, no three knockdown rule. You cannot be saved by the bell in any round, including the last round, and only the referee can stop the fight. Jim.
All right, Harold. Montel Griffin's dad ran a gym in Chicago called Windy City Boxing, and Griffin first went to the gym to train and learn the sport at age 5, later gave it up at age 12 after his father's death, when his mother, a Jehovah's Witness, forbade him to box until he reached adulthood, went back to the sport, and came out of nowhere in a one-year amateur whirlwind to make the Olympic team in 1992. As a professional, 14 wins, no losses, 8 KOs. Much of the time, he must scrape for a decision because he seems to lack finishing power against many good light heavyweight opponents. James Toney has fought once before as a light heavyweight, knocking out Anthony Hembrick at a time when Hembrick was ranked in the top 10. His overall record, 44 wins, the one loss to Roy Jones in his last fight, after which he said, "I can never make 168 pounds again." Having made 175 for this fight, he stepped on a scale in his locker room an hour and a half ago at 187 pounds. So again, he's gained 12 pounds between weigh-in and entry into the ring. Right now, let's go up to ring announcer Michael Buffer for the pre-fight introductions.
Ladies and gentlemen, good evening and welcome to the Grand Garden here at the MGM Grand of Las Vegas, Nevada, where tonight, Bob Arum's Top Rank Incorporated, along with your undisputed, undefeated King of Beers, Budweiser, this Bud's for you, presents an evening of championship boxing. Now, before we continue, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to make a special introduction. Sitting here at ringside tonight, along with his broadcasting partners from HBO Sports, Jim Lampley, Larry Merchant, and Harold Lederman, is a man who in 1968 captured Olympic gold. In 1973, he became heavyweight champion. He took a little time off, and then again, just 13 weeks ago, right here at the MGM Grand, once again became the heavyweight champion of the world, Big George. This bout is sanctioned by the Nevada State Athletic Commission, Chairman Dr. James Nave, Commissioners Nat Carasalli, Dr. Elias Ghanem, Luther Mack, and Crispin Rivera, Executive Director Mark Ratner, Chief Physician Dr. Flip Homansky, Physicians at Ringside Dr. Al Capanna, and Dr. William Berliner. The timekeepers are Jane Broadfoot and James Cavan. This bout is also sanctioned by the International Boxing Federation. Supervisor ringside is Dan Jones. The three judges scoring this bout on a 10-point must system will be Dwayne Ford, Bill Graham, and Art Lurie. And when the bell rings, the man in charge of the action, referee Joe Cortez. And now, ladies and gentlemen, from the MGM Grand of Las Vegas, 12 rounds of boxing for the IBF Intercontinental Light Heavyweight Championship. Introducing first, fighting out of the blue corner, wearing red with black letters, weighing 173 and one half pounds. From the windy city of Chicago, Illinois, he brings a perfect record as a professional into the ring of 14-0, 8 knockouts to his credit. Ladies and gentlemen, he is the undefeated Montel Ice Griffin. and his opponent across the ring, fighting out of the red corner, wearing black and weighing 175 pounds. From Ann Arbor, Michigan, he brings a professional record of 44 victories, only one defeat with two draws. 29 of those 44 victories by KO, and he's captured two world titles. Ladies and gentlemen, presenting the former middleweight, the former super middleweight champion of the world, James Lights Out Tony.
All right, Montel, Tony, we went over the rules in the dressing room. I won a good, clean fight. Obey my commands at all times. Shake hands. Good luck to both of you.
Tony has been suggesting that he would become more of a brawler and less of a boxer, but he's always been a very disciplined boxer puncher in the ring. Let's see how he deals with a fighter who is sometimes very unorthodox and difficult to get to.
And the final footnote on Tony and his woman manager, Jackie Callan. He had threatened not to wear the Star of David emblem on his trunks. He has always worn in the past to honor her. But as he enters the ring tonight, once again have the Star of David there, along with the skull and crossbones on the other legs and two crowns, emblematic of the two divisions in which he's won titles.
I wonder if an archaeologist found that 1,000 years from now, if he could decipher it, Jim. Star of David, skull and bones, two crowns.
Montel Griffin landing a jab, taking a page from Roy Jones's book. Griffin says he plans to try to de-emphasize the jab tonight and lead frequently with the left hook. It really worked for Jones on November 18 against Tony.
Well, Tony went out instantly going to the body, which is awful hard when you're shorter than a man and he's going to your body. Griffin is not accustomed to people going to his body, and Tony is going right to the chest. This guy is an expert boxer puncher, Tony is.
Hard punches early from Tony. He looks much better physically in the ring tonight than was the case after he made 168 on November 18. George, you don't see a lot of 5'7" light heavyweights. What are the implications of Griffin's height or lack of it in this match?
I think boxing has always been for the smaller men. It's the art of self-defense, so you're not to look down on him because of his size. As a matter of fact, bends down and comes back up and land good shots, hooks. He's going to have to land a lot of hooks. Forget about straight punching because he won't have that advantage. Everything should be in a hook fashion.
Landed a looping left to the neck and shoulder of Tony that got a rise out of the crowd, and a short right hand inside. Now Tony misses with a sweeping left.
But Tony has done something real fine. You watch it, throws that left right uppercut right to the chest.
Come on, work out of that. Come on, don't be holding his side. Don't be holding his side.
Big moment for Griffin, but he looks very relaxed in there, George. His trainer, Eddie Futch, says he is a uniquely relaxed fighter, very at home in the ring.
That's true, and he acts as well. Griffin is deceptive because his long arms are a lot longer than his body. It almost don't go along with his body. They're almost down to his knees.
He looks like a fire hydrant and fights like a lamppost.
Tony's got to get in that ring and realize he's James Tony and forget about his past. He's always been a good fighter. Nothing different about him now. Griffin has got to go out there, stay low, take advantage of his lack of height.
Griffin aggressive and relaxed in round one. It's been a good opening period for the unbeaten young prospect from Chicago.
All I can do is just give him a few more jabs. I like the right hand, but just a few more jabs to go. And get off a little faster. Get off a little faster. Rinse his mouth. Give him a little water. More jabs. When you come with that right hand, even if you miss it, come back with that left hook. I don't need it.
Thank you.
Keep giving those things. Just keep walking on. Look this guy over there, okay? Okay?
I don't know if Tony was a little puzzled by Griffin or if he was just measuring him to see what he has in the first round. We'll find out in this round.
Interesting that though the near legendary Eddie Futch works in Griffin's corner, it is Thel Torrence who talks to Griffin between rounds.
There's that good right uppercut right underneath that arm. Just under the breast. That hurt, especially when you've got 10, 12 rounds to go.
Griffin early in round two, taking as good as he's giving to the body. Exchanges of body punches, dominating the fight so far.
I've never seen a guy with a height advantage go down to the body like Tony is doing to Griffin. I've never seen it. Generally, you take advantage of your jab, and you go for the head shots and some body punches, but not totally like that. Let me tell you, those body punches have already started to take their effect.
Come on.
Griffin is starting to do what he said he would not do. Said he would box.
Well, James Toney said, I'm tired of boxing. I want a brawl. So perhaps by going to the body early, rather than using the jab and his height against Griffin, Tony's trying to elicit a brawl from the smaller fighter.
He's initiated it, and the brawl is on. Griffin is even going forward. One thing you don't want to do with James Toney, you don't want to move forward. Don't back him up.
Why's that?
You're going to run into some good right hands and powerful left hooks. You want to make Toney come after you.
Come on. Break out to me. Sit back.
As long as Tony is the aggressor, you're going to get hit with one or two shots. If you back him up, you're going to get hit with three and four and sometimes five punches.
Well, Roy Jones had the ideal formula. Tony came forward, became a target in doing so, but couldn't find Jones enough to punish him when he came forward with aggression.
There's no doubt about it. Tony is a good puncher. When he has you hurt, he moves forward effectively, but he's not going to do a whole lot of harm following you around because he does it with one shot.
James Toney still concentrating on Montel Griffin's body early. Griffin going upstairs and throwing that left jab that he said he would de-emphasize, but which has become a primary weapon early in the fight. Two more Griffin jabs. Toney with a short right hand inside.
And Griffin puts his left hand all the way down below his weight. Toney just keeps his eyes right on that left jab. Griffin should bring that left jab up a little higher if he wants to land it more often. As long as he keep it low, Tony's going to jab him even right in the chest.
Good job by Muhammad Ali, George. He's always going to hold that left low.
One thing that's quickly established is that Griffin is not concerned with Tony's strength. He thinks he's a natural light heavyweight, and he's fighting an overstuffed middleweight.
And look, remember, you can use that jab a little more often. See, because he's not expecting that jab to be that fast. Faint and sick, that hand.
Okay.
And remember that hook.
Okay.
Double hook once in a while. And when you're pulling out, don't pull out standing up straight.
Okay, pull out.
Yeah. Okay. All right.
That's good. He's too much high. Take your time.
Catch him now.
All right. Take your time. When you catch him, back with the hook, not one punch.
Eddie Futch, whose voice you heard a few moments ago in Griffin's corner, knew Griffin's dad, who had a gym, as Jim pointed out before, and he also trained Tony's father. So if you're around as long as Eddie Futch is, you've touched about just every corner there is in boxing.
That's right. Just about everyone in the sport. You heard Tony say to Bill Miller between rounds, I'm catching him now. And Miller said, don't forget to use the left hook. So both trainers asking their fighters for left hooks. And it's Griffin who gets the better of that exchange.
Well,
really looking to get underneath that left jab of Griffin. If he can get under Griffin's left jab, he doesn't care if he lands a punch occasionally. He's tasted his power already. He's not intimidated at all by this light heavyweight's power.
And Tony peekabooing there a bit against the ropes, George, maybe thinking that Griffin, at some point along the way, will get arm weary and lose his steam.
And not only is he arm weary already, he's almost frightened to kind of lead with that jab out there because Tony is going underneath.
Doesn't look frightened to me, George. He looks what his nickname is, Ice. He looks very cool in there. Seems comfortable in there, like a kid who did start in there when he was 5 years old.
Good left hook
by Griffin.
Outstanding. Montel Griffin proving an elusive target here in round three, and so far executing his fight plan.
Let me tell you, that left jab could have been a lot better, but Tony has got him throwing his left jab on the run now. Griffin is a little tentative. He doesn't want to lead. He's turning southpaw. He's doing a lot of desperate things.
He's going to make Tony mad with that stuff.
No, but Griffin is doing it because he's been hurt real casually, like, to the body, and it hurts.
So you like the way things are going for James, and you think punching power is showing up for him here as a light heavy.
He has his opponent now. He's throwing punches. He lands occasionally, but he's doing it so reluctantly as though I'm going to hit back.
Griffin manages to stay up. Tony goes down. That'll be ruled a slip. No knockdown. Griffin still wobbly. You were right about Tony finding his power at this weight, George. It was one punch that wobbled Griffin.
Now Tony has to jab if he's going to do it again.
And the bell stops Tony's assault.
Feel good enough, Don?
Yeah. All right, all right.
Okay.
Here's a look at that punch that wobbled.
Okay, I'm here to protect you. I'm here to make sure you take it.
Griffin, a straight right hand. He has almost been lured into this kind of exchange, which is uncharacteristic of the way he's fought in the past. And Tony finally found the range, but got a little excited and let him off the hook there, although it was the end of the round. Let's see what Griffin has left here at the start of the fourth round.
So the big right hand punctuates round three for Tony. Now the fourth begins. He's on Nevada State Athletic Commission. Dr. Flip Homansky checking on Griffin between rounds.
Tony landed his favorite shot, a counter right hand.
There's a hard left hook by Griffin. But at this moment, Tony definitely appears to be the heavier puncher.
Punch again out.
Now he's afraid to throw his right hand, and it's going to be his most effective punch. Tony is even going side to side. Not only is he in the pocket, stepping inside of the left hook and the right hand, jabbing to the body.
Griffin
lands another left hand as Tony takes a momentary breather. Typical of his behavior in the ring, the constantly voiced criticism from other fighters. Well, James never fights a full round. It never hurt him much until the Roy Jones fight.
Barely missed with that counter right hand.
Oh, Come on, punch it out. Punch it out of there.
Griffin relying increasingly on that leaping left hook. Maybe opening himself up to the right hand more frequently than he'd like.
Come on, get him out of here. Come on, fight that. Work out. Let's go.
Crowd just settling back in after that near knockdown that ended the third round.
It was interesting that Tony not only is able to weave under that left hook of Griffin and the right hand. He's countered with the right hand and he weaves under the left hook.
They trade hard punches inside, and Tony is getting the better of the exchanges as his power shots seem to do more damage.
And Griffin is cut.
Griffith showed some moxie, some stomach, some guile in that round to get through it. How much does he have left?
Jackie Callan, manager of James Toney and a fixture in his corner in the past, now is distanced from Tony's corner. Bill Miller free to do his work without the manager leaning in over the ropes.
Setting him up, baby. Keep setting
pick up the pace a little bit. Your night, James.
Your thing.
Pick up the pace. Your night, James.
Take him to another level now. I want to see something.
Good shit. It's your world, dog.
Deep breath.
It's your world. All right.
All right.
Take this boy to school. Take this boy to school.
Put a little more pressure on him now.
Take him to school, dog. All right, second out.
Give him another round. Just like that, okay? Okay. Oh, big boost in. You're the center of the ring, okay?
This is a good showing for a prize fighter with just 14 professional fights, George.
Yeah, but he's deceptive because he's got so much experience. He started boxing 5 years old.
Exactly. Harold Letterman, your score.
Larry, I'm impressed with Montel Griffin's punching, I tell you. It's a fight that's being fought under the microphone in the middle of the ring the entire four rounds. And I got it 3-1, 38-37, Montel Griffin by 1 point, because I think he's landing the cleaner shots. But certainly round three, 10-8 for James Toney when Griffin virtually went out.
I have it 2 rounds apiece at this time.
If Griffin's won a round here.
Keep him up, guys. Keep him up, both of you guys.
Harold says that Griffin's won 3 of them, George.
Oh, my goodness.
You haven't seen it, right?
I have not seen it.
Okay. So we have the requisite disagreement along the HBO ringside front.
All Griffin is doing is being set up, hurt to the body, and if he's not careful, staying close to Tony like that.
But he landed a hard left-hand shot, George.
Tony is a coaster. And you notice when Tony is landing a left hook now, Griffith is flinching.
Come on, work out of there, guys. Come on.
So the essence of what you're seeing is that Tony's punches do considerably more damage. Is that it?
Not only that, he's fighting the kind of fight that Tony wants him to fight. Tony loves those ropes. Griffith said he would not do that. Oh, and those body punches, the left hooks to the side by Tony. Not only does these punches hurt, but they destroy young fighters' career.
Another hard left-hand shot for Griffin. Tony with a couple in return. Remember that Tony spent the entire night against the ropes fighting Prince Charles Williams and managed eventually to chop Williams down with a knockout with 15 seconds remaining in the 12th round.
Remember, Griffin is trying to butt heads with a guy who's almost 190 pounds. But then he's fought light heavyweight before, too.
Hard right hand inside by Tony.
Watch your heads inside.
Rocked Griffin's head back. Montel content to stand right here and leave Tony in the corner as they trade inside shots.
Work out. Work out.
Tony always seems to finish with a left hook to the side.
Right hand by Tony, left hand by Griffin. Both fighters landing hard shots in the last 5 seconds of the round. This is the first of our two main events coming up immediately following Oscar De La Hoya, 1992 Olympic gold medalist, rising sensation of the lightweight division, 15 knockouts and 16 fights. Again, we say it, and this is the third or fourth time we've covered this point, toughest fight of De La Hoya's career on paper against former junior lightweight champion John Molina of Puerto Rico.
When you pull back after a jab, that's when he tries to pull that long right hand.
Okay.
Try to get underneath.
All right. Okay. Give me another round.
Light him up and turn him around.
They could have fought the fifth round in a phone booth. Only 9 jabs thrown in round 5 between the two fighters. 165 power shots.
Someone should tell Tony to adjust his right hand after he throws his left hook to bring it up just a little higher for protection. The only reason he's been hit by a counter left hook is because his hands are just a little lower.
But that's the scouting report on him, George, that he can be hit with the left hook as he just was there.
Little things like that, you bring in extra trainers to try to help you correct.
Another hard right hand by Tony, and you saw the scrape on the left eyelid of Griffin between rounds.
Get him out of there.
Good left hand shot to the body by James Tony.
And it was a jab, so you note, he's taking notes. Griffin moves around and walks around. This very professional for a guy with so few fights.
Work out of there.
Professional indeed, but prior to the Jones fight, few, if any, fighters in the sport were better at adjusting to the flow of the fight in the ring than James Tony.
He didn't pick any walkover coming off that emotional fight with Jones. This is a real fight now here, folks.
Tony says he'd like to fight 9 times in 1995. Ideally, he wants to fight in March, he wants to fight in April, he wants to fight in May, and just keep on going.
Has 2 more fights at the light heavyweight, he'll be down to a middleweight again, and he'll be happy to fight as a middleweight.
No, George. He's looking to become a cruiserweight and then a heavyweight, and like virtually everybody in the sport, he wants a date with you. Don't they all?
Don't they all? Tony has been accustomed to fighting his way down in weight. This time he's always had to go to the gym to do it.
He's had so much trouble making weight in the past that manager Jackie Callan literally suggested to him after the loss to Jones that he could go on national talk shows, complain that he had an eating disorder, and that that would boost the gate for a pay-per-view rematch.
Now, Tony is playing a game of trying to make him throw that left hook so he can counter over with that right hand again.
Payback, and referee Joe Cortez keeps him apart.
Hell yeah.
Look here. You're not jabbing enough.
Look here. That's sitting right there.
Montel Griffin has had 14 professional fights, and only 2 of them have gone past the 6th round.
Keep that chin down, use that jab, and use that fake that you were using earlier in the fight. And on the inside, you use that double hook. Double and triple.
Stay on the outside.
Pardon?
Stay on the outside?
I want you to stay on the outside. I want you to go in and out.
Oh, okay.
In and out. When you get inside, I want you to work inside.
There's the exchange. You'll hear the bell. Then you'll see the punch after the bell. Trust me, there was a bell.
Did you hear
it? All right, second out.
That bell signals the beginning of round seven. Only the third time in Montel Griffin's 15-fight career that he has been to a seventh round. You're probably aware of a young heavyweight prospect, hard puncher named Jeremy Williams. Jeremy Williams and Montel Griffin fought four times as amateurs. Williams winning the first two, Griffin winning the last two to eliminate a tearful Williams and make the 92 Olympic team. Hard right hand to the body by Montel Griffin. Tony appears unhurt by Griffin's hard shots.
And you know, he should never have allowed Tony to know that. You hurt me, I went up against the ropes, and you're not coming to get me. That means you got no confidence even when you hurt me a shot. Tony's just sitting right now trying to find out how in the world is this guy standing up to the punching power he's put on him already. Griffin's corner told him to jab a little bit, work on the outside, and he's not doing it.
Of body punches. Tony, though leaning against the ropes, just as busy as Griffin there. Hard right hand over the top by Tony.
Work out.
That left hook right on Tony's chops has been the best weapon so far for Montel Griffin.
Tony's constantly keeping up the pressure, throwing that right hand underneath the heart, they call it. And the left jab is making Griffin's head snap back now. That means there's no power in his legs now.
Hard left hand by Griffin, and Tony wobbles into the ropes.
It was a slip.
George, that slip was aided by a heck of a punch.
Yeah, he's hurt, George. May regain his senses before the end of the round, but James Toney fighting back with a fury here is trying to erase some of the damaging effects of an outstanding Montel Griffin wallop. Harold Lederman, did the ropes stop Toney from going down?
In my estimation, Jim, they definitely stopped him from going down. I called it 10-8 because Joe Cortez could have called it a knockdown. Officially, it wasn't a knockdown because Cortez didn't call it a knockdown, but he certainly could have.
Let's take a look and see what happened there.
That's it. It was not even a punch. It was a slip.
He hit him on the shoulder and followed up with a shot to the head. So it was.
Let's see it. That is a different way. Now, where's the head? Tony has a tendency to throw shots and look for the ropes, and the ropes are not there, and he goes stumbling back.
I think you're
He's
right.
He's one guy who looks to foul on the ropes and gets in trouble because of it.
Tough call, guys.
He loves his back touching the ropes like the great basketball player Moses Malone. He'd like for you to bump him first so he can throw his hook.
Of course, that was very reminiscent of the backward stagger that was ruled a knockdown in the third round of his fight with Roy Jones.
Jim, if you get hit on the end of a punch and you go down, that's a knockdown. And this guy gets hit with a shot. He goes into the ropes. If the ropes weren't there, he would have went down. It certainly could have been a knockdown. Got the fight at this point, 4-3, Montel Griffin, 66-65, Montel Griffin by 1 point. I called round 7, 10-8 Griffin because of what I thought could have been a knockdown, and certainly 10-8 Tony in the third.
And Griffin's confidence again increases as he trades shots with Tony in the middle of the ring.
I have the fight even with one even round, but I do know this. Tony is a 4-1 favorite, but Griffin is not fighting like a 4-1 underdog.
That's for certain. Griffin is going to make a lot of friends.
Yeah, but you said earlier, George, that you didn't think he'd won a round. Do you still believe Griffin has
not a round? Not a round.
Didn't win the seventh.
No, if he's got a round, it's because someone gave it to him.
So on the one hand, he's impressing you, but on the other hand, you don't think he's won a round.
He recovers quick. Tony is throwing some body punches like I've never seen anyone throw to a short opponent.
Boy, that was a hard left-hand shot there by Tony, but it was a little bit extended.
Griffin is trying to get his head right on Tony's shoulder, right on his chest, which is a difficult thing to do. You see, now Tony reaches for the ropes. He likes leaning on the rope.
Good hard right hand body shot by James Toney. And Griffin lands the left as he steps away. Hard right hand again by Toney, and again Griffin's feet leave the canvas.
You would never guess that Tony ever was a middleweight with that much power in the light heavyweight.
Of course, he thinks for 3 years he wasn't a middleweight. For 3 years he was a light heavyweight, starving himself to fight as a middleweight. That's the way he sees it. Griffin's face beginning to show the evidence of Tony's hard punches for 8 rounds of this fight.
Tony had no idea that Griffin would be that tough.
Break out clean.
Now, I'm not sure Montel thought that James would be this stiff a puncher coming up in weight class.
Griffin hasn't gone down, but he sure has done some funny things standing up, George. He's shown us some steps.
With 1 point behind. Let's take over the fight, son.
Take over, baby. You can hurt him when you want.
Look here. When you just step to the left and shoot the left hook. With the left hook. I want to see it. Well, tell me, okay, Pop. Jab, step to the left, pop that hook. All right. Put some pressure on this man. I ain't seen a right hand down the pike since that one you hit him and hurt him with. Let me see something.
Let's meet that jab. On the inside, you've got to work. Right. And you can't come out standing up straight. You've got to come down low.
Get the towel.
And to the right.
All
right. Well, to your right.
Out.
All right.
4 seconds out.
Give me another round. One, two, three.
Well, let's see if Tony can give Bill Miller that right hand down the pipe he's looking for.
They told Tony to give a left hook and he went out there and missed with it.
Work out
of good short left inside by Tony.
Good right hand by Griffin that time.
Get him out of there. Get those arms out. You can work out of there. Come on.
Griffin cannot throw his left jab at the same time as Tony's. He's got to find a rhythm that he beats him to the jab and not jab along with him.
Get him out.
I don't know how much Tony's punches hurt, but Griffin's trunks are beginning to unravel, sequin by thread by sequin.
So you're saying that James is knocking the sequins off of him?
He sure is, at the moment.
Well, that helps to set up the narrative for the second fight, in which Oscar De La Hoya wants to knock the hairpiece off of John Molina's head. We'll get to that later. George, should Tony be worried about getting into a situation where this fight could go to a decision?
I think so. Whenever you are punching, you've been landing the best punches, you should always concern yourself that the judges sometimes are counting all those little punches that don't hurt you. You got to be concerned.
You may have noticed between rounds, our punch stat numbers showed a much higher punch output for James Toney, but showed Griffin landing at a higher rate.
And sometimes you find yourself saying, this hurt this guy, I've hurt him again, and not understanding that the little punches count too. Tony could find himself in big trouble waiting around for a decision.
The crowd comes alive again. Griffin's blood on Tony's shoulder. James landing the hard overhand right, trying to step up the damage in the latter stages of round nine.
Tony's right hand is going to the side of Griffin's head. And he's, if he could just take it a little straighter, just a little straighter.
Griffin still fires at will with that left hook, George, as James Toney keeps his right hand down.
Give me more than that. Huh? You can give me better than that, can't you? Well, give it to me.
No, you're in great shape. This monkey can't do nothing with you.
I got the arrow.
Shoot yourself, baby. Don't shoot yourself. You
need we're coming down the wire. This is our rounds.
Come on.
We need all of these. We need every round to come in.
You get home now. You need him again, right? Mm-hmm. All right. So go and take him over Bobby's bitch.
Hey,
let's keep that pressure off.
Dave, you got a chance. Step left and come back with a power left hook.
All right, let's go now.
Keep that pressure on.
Keep the pressure.
Don't cut off.
All right, seconds out.
James Toney's punches landing at a lower rate tonight than was the case through his last three fights as a super middleweight. Maybe because he's concentrating more on power shots here.
He came out with a flicking right hand, which is what he should be doing a little bit more. So you got to give the judges something.
Tony largely dispensing with the jab. Montel Griffin using it more and more to try to keep James off of it.
Tony's got a small cut underneath his eye also. Got to be a little concerned about to keep bumping heads like that.
Hard for me to tell the way they treated it in his quarter between rounds, whether that was his blood or Griffin's. Now Griffin assumes command again for a moment, or at least thinks he does.
He's got to understand that Griffin is not looking for any telltale signs that I hurt you. Everything he's doing is because, hey, I'm landing points.
I think Griffin's probably hoping to get through three more rounds and then waiting to hear what the judges have to say.
There's that left hook by Griffin.
Get him out of there. Come on, get him out.
Tony should keep his right hand up just a little more.
An aggressive Montel Griffin stepping forward in the middle of round 10. Tony seemingly a little unsure in this round, George, as to exactly what it is he wants to do.
That's right. He's done everything he's wanted to do previously. Now it's a matter of what am I going to do different. Whoa, did that hurt, that left hook by Tony. But Griffin recovers quickly.
Okay, he's a well-conditioned fighter.
Those shots hurt.
These two fighters sparred with each other in Jackie Callan's gym after the Olympics in 92, when Jackie was interested in signing Montel Griffin to a contract. Spent a couple days there, sparred with Tony, and said, I didn't like the way Tony's personality dominated that gym. I felt I should go elsewhere.
Good right hand by Tony.
Left in return by Griffin.
Let's go.
But it's like those bullfighters, once they stick you with that thing on the back of your neck, they want you to keep fighting back. makes the punches more effective.
The fight to score. It will be fascinating to see what three Nevada judges have to say about this one. Remember that when last we looked, our unofficial ringside scorer, Harold Letterman, had Griffin leading in the bout.
You can believe that the doctors are going to step in and look at Griffin this round.
Because of the blood?
He's been hit with some tough shots.
He's tired. You got to listen, okay? Listen, okay? When you throw your punches, you walk around to the right. Don't stand right in front of him, okay?
He's tired.
Give me the top.
He's very tired. Keep that jab pumping, moving up, and looking for your shot all the time.
Two more.
Okay,
two more. All this guy, I'm going to get my second win now.
Okay, all right.
He's trying to get some air and fighting spurts. You know what I'm saying?
But you got to keep moving the jab.
Yeah, keep that jab.
Harold Letterman, 10 rounds, your score.
Larry, a very close 6-4. 95-93, James Toney. I thought he did enough with hand speed to win rounds 8, 9, and 10. To take the lead in the championship rounds, I think he's turning it on a little. And I think the heavy arms of Montel Griffin are starting to show. The guy's just tired.
I have Toney ahead by a point now.
I got the water quick.
They go into round 11. Second time past the 10th round for Montel Griffin. For James Toney, it's the 11th time in his career that he has fought more than 10 rounds.
And he's constantly throwing that right uppercut to the body. Griffith said in the corner that he's getting his second win together. That could be trouble for Toney.
Punch stat numbers through 10 rounds. Toney throwing 131 more punches than Griffin, but Griffin landing just as many as James. So he has the higher connect percentage, according to our punch stat computer operators.
Good right uppercut by Toney. First time all night that he's countered a left jab with a right uppercut onto the head.
Toney with hard right hands to the body. 5 minutes of fighting time left.
Good right hand by Griffin.
Activity level picking up just a little bit now. Let's see how hard Toney tries to take this out of the hands of the judges in the last 4.5 minutes of the fight.
Break out clean.
George, as a former two-time world champion, will James Toney get the likely benefit of the doubt from the judges?
No doubt about it. The judges got to understand that Toney has a rhythm, he has a style, and when he's going forward, jabbing at tape, he's doing what he want to do. The judges are going to respect this. He's been around long enough to know, and they know exactly what he's doing.
Toney's left eye closing just a little bit. We've charted the damage on Montel Griffin's face from the beginning.
All right, break out.
And now after a pretty active first 2 minutes in round 11, they both look a little tired as they come down the stretch of the 11th.
Toney's looking for a knockout now. He no longer wants to body punch and trade. He wants a knockout.
What would be the best way to get it, George?
He's going to have to now kind of bring his left hook underneath and finish it with a right hand. Bring the man's head up to your right hand. Now he's throwing a jab, and he goes down, and he misses with the left jab. Left uppercut, right hand is what it's going to take. Not a left jab and right hand.
Montel Griffin clearly tired, not able to throw many punches in the last minute of this round.
To have 3 minutes. Give me 3 minutes.
Lean up, James. Lean up.
3 minutes to win this fight. But we need it. Don't blow your nose. We got to have this last round. I
need this last round. You hear me?
You want this fight, man? Listen, you want this fight, you can take it, okay? Yeah. But you got to be smart. Yeah. Don't give him money. Box the guy, keep the left hand, keep walking around his right. Okay?
Touch him up.
You know what I'm saying? Right. Don't let him get nothing. He'll come out with a spurt, but I want you to be smart.
Yeah. In the night.
Get it home.
All right?
Get home, y'all. Let him happen, baby.
Fight.
Get home, let him happen.
All right. Yeah, we'll
have it. No prisoners, James.
Let's get this motherfucker.
All right.
Counterpunch.
Get out of it. Okay?
Might still be able to pull this fight out. James Toney is going to have to work in this 12th round.
A vast difference in experience may be evident here. The 48th professional fight of James Toney's career, the 15th for Montel Griffin.
If I'm Griffin, I'll hit and hold. He'll be renowned if he can go 12 rounds with James Toney.
If you're Tony,
hey, keep your left jab going. Now you'll go with a right hand every now and then, but don't go trying to finish him and give him a chance to get a flash knockdown on you.
And that one just missed, and it gives Griffin a clear picture of what Tony will be trying to do in the round. Good left hook inside by Tony.
Come on, give me a clean round, guys. Give me a clean round.
Griffin pushes James away, and now will fire the jab from time to time to try to keep Tony off of it. Tony comes forward with the right hand and lands it.
And did it hurt? It was high on top of the head. The only thing that kept Griffin up, the right hand was too high. There's got to be a left uppercut in the right hand if Tony wants to catch him. He can't just throw his left jab out there.
Somewhere in Chicago, Montel Griffin's Jehovah's Witness mother hates the fact that he's fighting. But he had to do what he wanted to do. It took him to the Olympics in 92. Can it bring him to an upset victory over James Toney tonight? For Toney, what's at stake is nothing short of the rebirth of his career in the wake of a devastating loss to Roy Jones. Can he once again be one of the best in the world?
All right, bring it up.
Tony is true to the profession. He's seeking a knockout every minute.
Why'd you get out? Come on, why'd you get out of there?
And you never count out James's chance to score the knockout. Remember, he knocked out Prince Charles Williams in this ring last summer with 15 seconds to go.
Griffin is doing what I would have told him to do. You make it 12 rounds, be famous. Don't go in there trying to mix it up with one of the best punchers in the in this weight division.
Tony is coming down the stretch like a thoroughbred here. If he needs this round to win the fight, he appears to be winning it.
Yeah, I think Griffin just sort of ran out of gas. Physically and maybe mentally as well in the last two rounds.
Griffin looked up to the clock. He wants to know how much time he's got.
Got and finishes with a savage flurry. And both fighters dance around the ring in a victory pantomime.
My favorite fighter, man. But it's busy, man. I love you, man. I love you a lot, man.
The distance. What do you have, Harold Lederman?
Jim, I got it 7-5, 114, 112, James Toney. I thought James actually did pull out the last round. I thought he pulled out 4 out of the last 5, to tell you the honest to God's truth. Montel Griffin certainly had a good round around 11, made it very, very close. I had 2 10-8 rounds without a knockdown because there were two really staggers that almost were knockdowns. I mean, certainly James Toney deserved the 10-8 in the third. Montel Griffin definitely deserved the 10-8 in the seventh. But I thought James Toney did enough punching to pull the fight out. I honestly think that this fight may be a split decision.
So your instinct is to look for a split decision. And I can see promoter Bob Arum in the ring looking over Michael Buffer's shoulder to try to get a look at the cards. let's go to Michael Buffer to find out who won the fight.
Ladies and gentlemen, here at the MGM Grand, we go to the scorecards. Dwayne Ford scores the bell. 114 to 114, he has it even. Bill Graham scores the bell. 115 to 113, and Art Lurie scores it 116 to 112 for the winner by majority decision, Montel Ice.
Developing career of young Montel Griffin. A shocking loss by decision for James Toney. And yet another lesson in how difficult it is to handle the subjective task of judging a boxing match. Larry Merchant stands by in the ring. Larry.
James, your feelings about the scoring?
I thought I won the fight. I did have to win the fight, but just didn't see it my way, so. He got the decision.
Was he a tougher fight coming off such an emotional fight as your last one than you thought it would be?
No, not at all. It was just, just the judges, I got a bad decision.
Was he a hard guy to fight because of his size?
No, not really. I did what I had to do to win. But hey, I didn't get the decision late. Oh, I'll be back. No problem.
Are you in shock?
I'm in shock. Yeah, I'm in shock. I lost the fight, I had a guy beat.
I'm in shock. I'm amazed.
Thank you, James. Jim?
James Toney and Jackie Callan, are you in shock, George?
More than anything, than words could ever mention. Shocked.
So you think this is a highly questionable decision?
It's really a blow to a wonderful sport. It's a blow to a wonderful gladiator. And really, it's an insult to a great night. I don't know how it happened.
But, George, it's a relatively close fight. I mean, the guy is in the fight all the way in the eyes of most. You heard how Harold scored it. I think that you'd be in a small minority in saying that James won all the early
minority.
Rounds.
I might be a minority.
You'd be a large minority. That's a very good point in saying that James won all the early rounds.
If Montel Williams won that fight, cows lay eggs.
All right, what is it that the judges failed to understand or grasp? Is it Tony's punching power, punch by punch, that they missed?
Oh, if you try to rationalize why they did that, it would even make it even greater an insult. It's strange things have happened. As Howard Cosell, my sitting here, I just got to tell it like it is.
So you think it's just shocked. Inexplicable, cannot be explained.
No, you just can't explain it. It's a shocking, and I just don't see how it happened. This guy was staggered throughout the ring, throughout the fight. James Toney even helped him up a few times, trying to seek a knockout. What are you going to give him? Aggression? No, I'm not buying that. Look, I buy cheeseburgers, but I don't buy those hot dogs.
Larry Merchant stands
by. Yes, I do. I buy hot dogs too. I take that bet.
You do. Larry Merchant stands by in the ring with the winner, Montel Griffin.
Montel Griffin, congratulations. Were you surprised that in a fight against such a highly known, high-profile prize fighter that you got the decision?
No, I'm not surprised. I mean, I thought I jabbed him really 3-1, 4-1. My hardest shots was much cleaner than his. My jab, he was running too hard, snapping his head back every time. So, I'm not surprised. I thought I'd box him. I didn't know when they said the first judge scored it a draw. I was like, oh, my goodness. They got me, but.
He hurt you early in the fight. You kept your balance somehow. How badly were you hurt?
It was just a surprise punch caught me off balance. I didn't see it. And I regrouped together real good. I moved around, cleared up my head, and went back to business.
Did you surprise him, do you think, by sticking your head on his chest a lot? That's not very characteristic of the way you have fought many fights.
Right, well, with James Toney, even though he's not that tall of a light heavyweight, he needs room to throw punches. He likes to wing his punches. He needs the room. So I shot the jab, made him run into it, and I clinched, then I stepped around to the right and tried to get my left hook up off. Right, but I didn't land my left hook like I wanted to.
This is your first big professional fight. What do you attribute to the fact that you were able to maintain your poise, not get excited, and so on. Is this because you started so young in the ring?
Well, first of all, I dedicate this to my father, Clarence Griffin. If it wasn't for him, I would never be here. And I also give thanks to my boss man, Eddie Futch, Dale Torrance, and Hedgman Lewis, my brother, Tim Griffin. They took me over 2 years ago, taught me little things, ins and out, but just by nature, I'm just a very low-key, relaxed person. So, you know, when I got hurt or he caught me at a good shot, I stay relaxed. I'm a man, you know. I was ready for this. This is how superstars are born. They got to beat somebody who's up there. So this is how you're born.
Thank you very much, Montel. Again, congratulations.